Dear Maria Theresa, dear Tittmeyer family, dear Jens, dear Minister Schauble, dear President Köhler, dear President Mario Draghi. It is for me extraordinarily moving to have been invited by Jens to pay homage to my friend, Hans Tittmeyer, in presence of Horst Köhler, can I say also my friend Horst Köhler, former President of the Republic, of you, Wolfgang, with whom we had so many interactions, and with Mario Draghi, President of the European Central Bank. I have a very vivid memory of all my encounters with Hans here in this Bundesbank house, of his invitation to have dinner here, to spend the night in one of the nice rooms that are here, and work the next morning on issues of common interest. Also in your house, Maria Theresa, a lot of memory, and you know that your artistic talent were always with me, because I had in my office, in the president office, in the ECB, your Notre Dame de Paris, admirably painted by you, Maria Theresa. We had in the Bundesbank and in Banque de France many issues of common interest in the 80s and the 90s, which were decisive years for European convergence in the run-up to the euro. But not only in the central banks, also in the various governments. There has been a remarkable parallelism of our careers for Hans and I. We both were approximately at the same time Staatssekretär and Director du Trésor of our Ministries of Finance. Our cooperation was extremely close in that mandate in period 87 up to 90, which was so important for the stabilization of the relationship between the Deutsche Mark and the French franc within the exchange rate mechanism. By the way, very often in France, I remind my compatriots that the last realignment between the French franc and the Deutsche Mark was made in January 87, so that 12 years before the start of the euro, we had already a cross rate that was the same at the moment of the merger of the currencies. We had some difficult periods from time to time, during which Hans Tittmeyer played a very important role in helping to find appropriate solutions, either, again, as a Staatssekretär or Vice President of the Bundesbank or President of the Bundesbank. The period preceding the euro inception was difficult in many respects. As was said very eloquently, Germany had to cope with its reunification and the immense challenges associated with this extraordinary historical event. And Hans was at the heart of this historical event. France at the time was pursuing its long-term multi-partisan strategy of competitive disinflation, which started at the beginning of the 80s and was part of its goal to be ready for monetary union when time would come. But there was not a single other European country which didn't have to cope with enormous challenges, and Mario knows better than anybody all what we had to cope with in this European team. And again, we had very difficult moments, particularly in 92 and 93, with two successive crises of the exchange rate mechanism, which were really very, very acute. Hans Tittmeyer was always a fantastic central banker, inflexibly attached to monetary stability, to independence, and to medium-long-term vision, a highly lucid economist and a fully dedicated European. And both Jens and Wolfgang have very eloquently explained us that were the main dimension of Hans Tittmeyer as regards his principle. As economist, he always stressed the importance of the economic and fiscal governance inside the euro area. I entirely shared this view inside my own country to the risk of having some quarrels from time to time with the political sphere. I was sometimes qualified as Ayatollah of the strong franc, franc fort. I think that Carlo Otto made the joke in French, which gave me the nickname also of Tittmeyer's clone, which I accepted with pride. Theo Weigel once told me the story of the French President Jacques Chirac making public his disagreement with the German technocrats that were calling for the dry comma null of the Stability and Growth Pact. Theo Weigel went to the president and said, "Are you accusing Hans Dittmeyer? Are you accusing Horst Köhler?" "And as far as I am concerned," said Theo Weigel, "I am not a technocrat, I am the Minister of Finance of Germany." To whom the response of the president was, "I was not thinking of them, I was thinking of Trichet." And which triggered the immediate response of Theo Weigel, "But Dittmeyer is a German, but Trichet is not a German," which was obviously true. Hans Dittmeyer was immensely respected in the world. It was also very eloquently said as an eminent Sherpa when he was Staatssekretär, and then as the eminent president of the Bundesbank. And you reminded all of us that part of the informal global governance of today comes out of the proposal of Hans, the Financial Stability Forum. As a civil servant before being president of the Bundesbank, he was already highly considered by the French prime ministers. I have two anecdotes in this regard. Once I was discussing with Raymond Barre, former prime minister. I was at the time at the French treasury. Raymond Barre was not anymore prime minister, and Giscard d'Estaing was not anymore president of the Republic. And Barre was asking me, "What are you doing now?" I told him I was deputy director of the treasury, in charge in particular with the European issues. And the response of Raymond Barre was immediate. He told me with his very personal accent, "Oh, if you are dealing with Europe, you must be in touch with Mr. Dittmeyer. He's very tough, very, very tough." I think that it was the memory of the contact he had with Hans, when Hans was, of course, in the German Minister of Finance, and Raymond Barre was commissaire, and he could see how principled was Hans. Later, in another occasion, Monsieur Balladur asked me in a Franco-German meeting, "Don't you think that your eminent friend Dittmeyer has an extraordinary resemblance with Luther?" To which I answered, "He's such a good Catholic that I have a real difficulty to make the rapprochement." The intellectual dimension of Hans Dittmeyer was as considerable as was his very profound experience. He was not only a remarkable economist and an eminent conceptual master of monetary policy, but he was dedicated in history, German history as well as European history. I will always remember the lecture he gave me on the Westphalia Treaty when we were both in Münster. Hans was crediting the treaty, rightly so, with providing the foundation of the modern state system and setting up the modern concept of sovereignty. At the same time, he was making the point that the very nature of the post-World War II European construction was precisely to go over and above the Westphalia concept with a new concept of shared sovereignty. He also drew my attention, to my own confusion, I have to say, on Nicolas Oresme, Bishop of Lisieux, not sufficiently recognized in France, but impressive French philosopher of the later Middle Ages. Oresme was the author of the treaty on the origin, nature, law, and alterations of money, in which he stated, "I am of the opinion that the main and final cause why the prince pretends to the power of altering the coinage is the profit or gain which he can get for it. Therefore," Hans told me, "Oresme advised the French Dauphin, the future King of France, Charles V, to create a monetary unit which would not be depreciated. This unit was created in 1360 and was called at the time the franc." So again, a lecture. Let me now turn to German, if you can forgive my very imperfect accent. Für die Vergebung ihrer Sünde und für die Vergebung meiner Sünde werde ich Deutsch sprechen. Die Auswirkungen der weltweiten Finanzkrise, die 2007-2008 durch die Subprimes und den Bankrott von Lehman Brothers ausgelöst wurde, erlaubt zwei Interpretationen. Man kann die Schwäche der Europäischen Union in the Bonstere des Euroraums, die Anfälligkeit der Wirtschaft und Finanzsystems dieser Zone und die Schwierigkeiten von fünf oder sechs Mitgliedern der Wirtschaft und Währungsunion, vor allem Griechenland, hervorheben. Unter diesem Blickwinkel scheint der Zusammenbruch des europäischen Projekts gewiss. Kündigte doch die Staatsschuldenkrise Ende 2009, Anfang 2010 bereits den allmählichen Zerfall des Euroraums und der gesamten Europäischen Union an.
European Union.
Mit dem Brexit verliert heute die europäische Marguerite die erste Strahlenblüte, die übrigen könnten bald folgen. Die amerikanische Exekutive dürfte diese Ansicht vertreten. Traditioneller Nationalismus, protektionistische Bewegungen, links und rechts, Extremismus in Europa und politische Trends, die in den angelsächsischen Ländern immer größeren Anklang finden. Das Zusammentreffen dieser Tendenzen erklärt, weshalb viele Diskurse über die Europäische Union und das historische Projekt eines vereinigten Europas sich auf die Idee berufen, dass dieses Projekt hauptsächlich darum leidet, überhaupt zu bestehen. Ziel ist es nicht mehr, die Hindernisse, vor denen Europa steht, zu bewältigen und aus der Vergangenheit zu lernen, um wieder Fortschritte zu machen, sondern den unausweichlichen Zusammenbruch zu beschleunigen. Der Diskurs ist so präsent, beziehungsweise so dominant, dass sogar die Verteidiger einer Union ihn für nicht sich nutzen und ganz einfach ummützen.
Das Fortbestehen
Europas ist in der Tat bedroht. Aus diesem Grund müssen sofort neue und umfassende Maßnahmen getroffen werden. Das stimmt.
That is correct.
Ich bin allerdings However, nicht sicher, ob es
so
das beste Argument ist,
also
denn es bekräftigt die These des kranken Europas und trägt dazu bei, Europa in den Augen aller Partner
in
und in seinen eigenen Augen zu schwächen. Ich lege die jüngsten Ereignisse anders aus, denn meines Erachtens ist absolut nicht das Bestehen des historischen Projekts Europa problematisch. Im Gegenteil, die Ereignisse der letzten 10 Jahre belegen die bemerkenswerte Widerstandsfähigkeit Europas und seiner Währung in der schwersten weltweiten Finanzkrise seit dem Zweiten Weltkrieg. An Beweisen mangelt es nicht. Erstens gab es auf unserem Kontinent keinen Konkurs wie den von Lehman Brothers. Diese Jahre waren zwar turbulent, aber die Europäische Zentralbank, die einzelnen Mitgliedstaaten und die europäischen Einrichtungen waren in der Lage, den Konkurs einer systemrelevanten Bank zu vermeiden. Das war nicht einfach, mussten doch alle 15 Länder des Euroraums die entsprechenden Entscheidungen treffen. Zweitens zeigte die europäische Einheitswährung in der Finanzkrise eine bemerkenswerte Solidität, obwohl die meisten Analysten und Marktteilnehmer in der USA bereits ihren Untergang vorhergesagt hatten. Drittens bewies auch der Euroraum selbst, der nach Ansicht vieler Beobachter dem Zerfall geweiht war, eine beeindruckende Widerstandsfähigkeit. Als Lehman Brothers insolvent wurde, zählte sie 15 Länder. The Euroregion consisted of 15 countries.
Today, these 15 countries, including Greece, are still part of it.
In der Krise wurden
and
sogar
right in the midst of the crisis,
weitere Länder aufgenommen.
Even four new members were
heute,
accepted.
Mehr als acht Jahre
today,
nach dem
more than 8 years
der
after the start
Finanzkrise,
of the worldwide financial crisis,
die Eurozone
the Eurozone by now comprises
Mitglieder.
19 members.
Ein Währungsraum, der dem Untergang geweiht sein soll,
an allegedly doomed
single
currency region
in schwierigen Zeiten einen
with such an expansion at difficult times clearly proves the contrary.
Deuten die Umfragen
fourthly,
im Gegensatz
surveys
zur gegen Meinung nicht auf
to the current common opinion do not indicate any renunciation of the single currency or any departure from it.
Dem jüngsten Eurobarometer zufolge, dessen Ergebnisse im Dezember 2016 veröffentlicht wurden, begrüßen 70% unserer europäischen Mitbürger eine. Ich zitiere den Satz. Eine Wirtschafts- und Währungsunion mit dem Euro als gemeinsamer Währung. Dieser Prozentsatz ist der höchste seit der Einführung des Euro. Nur 2004, 2007 und 2008 vor dem Konkurs von Lehman Brothers erreichte er ein ähnliches Niveau. Die Zugehörigkeit zum Euroraum war ein zentrales Thema bei den französischen Präsidentschaftswahlen. Die Antwort der Franzosen in dieser Hinsicht fiel klar und unmissverständlich aus und entsprach den Prognosen der Meinungsumfrage. Meine amerikanischen und britischen Bekannten sind erstaunt, wenn ich sie daran erinnere, dass dem Eurobarometer zufolge auch 81% der Deutschen der vorstehenden Aussage beipflichten. I'm sorry. So, die Widerstandsfähigkeit des Euro und des Euroraums und die umfassende Unterstützung in der Bevölkerung verdeutlichen, dass das historische Projekt Europa keineswegs schwächer und dem Untergang geweiht ist. Ein Fortbestand unter widrigen Umständen mag zwar bemerkenswert sein, doch dies genügt nicht, denn für Europa geht es nicht um das einfache Überleben, sondern um den langfristigen Erfolg. Europa muss in der Lage sein, die Innovation zu fördern, das Wachstum zu beschleunigen und ausreichend Arbeitsplätze zu schaffen, um die volle Beschäftigung der Bevölkerung sicherzustellen. Es muss für die interne und die externe Sicherheit sorgen und die europäischen Grenzen wirksam kontrollieren. Ferner sind die exekutive und die demokratische Legitimität dieser Governance zu stärken. Diese beiden Gründe veranlassten mich bereits 2011 die Einrichtung eines Finanzministeriums für den Euroraum und die Bildung einer Formation Euroraum in die Europäischen Parlament vorzuschlagen. In Europa leben wir in einer Zeit, in der sich die Geschichte entwickelt und selbst ihren Lauf bestimmt. Geschichte, die sich entwickelt, ist nicht im Voraus geschrieben. Manche sind der Ansicht, zu innovative und zu mutige Ideen wären nicht zu realisieren und Verträge könnten nicht geändert werden. Jean Monnet war nicht dieser Meinung. Ich zitiere den Satz. Ceux qui ne veulent rien entreprendre parce qu'ils ne sont pas assurés que les choses iront comme ils l'ont arrêté à l'avance se condamnent à l'immobilité. Wer nichts unternehmen will,
those who do not want to start a bold project, he says, because they are
so
not sure of the success,
wie es im Voraus bestimmt hat, werden sich zur
condemning
Immobilität.
Themselves to be immobile.
Can I say that it is indeed a great privilege to live in a period where history in the making, and I have to say, perhaps also to talk to those who are making history today. Europe has still a lot of progress to make in a historical perspective. There are many challenges to cope with, but one thing is sure. Since the setting up of the Economic and Monetary Union 18 years and a half ago, the euro proved to be a stable and credible currency with an average level of yearly inflation inferior to the average national inflation, which was observed for all previous national currencies before the euro. So the ECB monetary anchor of price stability, as I said, inflexibly called by Hans Dietmeyer, has delivered. Of course, we have to continue to care for this delivery. But this is something that was at the heart of the historical project. As regards new advances in the other dimensions of the European construction, I am resolutely optimistic now, particularly after the French election, which I mentioned, because I think that conditions are progressively met for new significant progress. I'm sure that Hans, who played such an important role in the setting up of the euro and had always asked for appropriate advances in political Europe as well as in economic and monetary dimension, that was the constant call, would be very happy to see the possibilities likely to be offered by the present situation. I'm sure that he would stand ready to promote ideas based upon his conviction that a strong political legitimacy through appropriate institutions were the necessary counterpart of economic and monetary union. And I know that in the present uncertain and volatile economic and political environment in Europe and in the world, Hans Dietmeyer would more than ever make the point that we should provide to our fellow citizens very solid anchors of credibility, of stability, and of medium and long-term confidence in all dimensions of the European construction. I thank you very much for your attention.